You guys often ask me in the comments about the blue zones. What do I think about them? Are they reliable or not? But we've never actually made a video about the blue zones. Well, Netflix beat us to it. They have a show about the blue zones. Darn it, Netflix. The blue zones are 5 regions scattered all over the world where they have found a high concentration of centenarians, people who made it to 100 years old. The show follows Dan Buettner, who first wrote about the blue zones on National Geographic and then later published a best-selling book on the same topic. So Dan serves as kind of our tour guide through the 5 zones. Okinawa, an island in the south of Japan. Sardinia, off the coast of Italy. Loma Linda, in California. Ikaria, one of the Greek islands. And Nicoya, in Costa Rica. The show is visually beautiful. It's beautifully shot. The images are absolutely gorgeous. And I read the Blue Zones book many years ago, but actually seeing what these places look like is a completely different experience. But the real stars of the show, without a doubt, are the centenarians. We meet a Japanese great-grandmother who still sings and dances at the ripe young age of 101. And a Costa Rican man who, at the age of 100, looks half his age. These people aren't bedridden. They're still living normal lives and doing their daily chores. And they have great personalities and sense of humor.
What's the best tea to drink on a daily basis?
Tokarashiki.
Wine.
Great tea.
These are some of the most naturally charming and endearing people you're ever going to see on film. Dan Buettner also walks us through his scientific process. In each region, he looks for characteristics of their behavior or their culture that he thinks may underlie their extreme longevity. And then he triangulates over the 5 regions to look for commonalities. In the end, he distills 4 keys. Move naturally. In all blue zones, people stay physically active, often just through their manual work and moving around over the course of the day. In Okinawa, this means sitting on the floor and getting up dozens of times a day. In Sardinia, this means walking up and down steep hills. Regardless of the specific activity, they all find ways to move constantly. Outlook. Whether it's through their religion or their culture, people in blue zones have a sense of purpose that keeps them going. They also find time to relax and recharge. It's not 24/7 stress. Eat wisely. Historically, the diet of the blue zones was centered around natural products, rich in fiber-containing foods, with little or no ultra-processed products. They also tend to not stuff themselves. The Okinawans even have a saying, "Hara Hachi Bu," which comes from Confucian teaching and translates to "belly 8 parts." Basically, eat till you're 80% full and then stop. And finally, the 4th key is connect. The inhabitants of the blue zones have rich social lives. They stay close to their family and friends. The elderly are not sent off to retirement homes. They stay with the families. There's a strong sense of community and partnership. I think this process of looking for clues and then triangulating to find commonalities is genius, and learning about these cultures is fascinating. I highly recommend watching the show. It's very well done and very entertaining and informative. My main reservation is that sometimes the conclusions are taken a little too far. The observations from the blue zones are really interesting clues, hints, but they don't amount to a demonstration. The blue zones are a type of scientific evidence called ecological data, basically looking at different populations in different parts of the world and trying to relate their characteristics or their behavior to their state of health. This type of evidence can provide really interesting clues that can then be tested in tighter experiments like randomized trials and cohort studies. But we have to be careful with ecological data because there are so many moving parts. Comparing the villagers of Okinawa to a typical New Yorker involves thousands of differences. Cultural, environmental, genetic, you name it. So it's really difficult to isolate causes from this type of comparison. The 4 keys that Buettner proposes make a lot of sense, and there's a lot of scientific evidence behind the health value of these things. But if we're playing devil's advocate, Aren't there thousands of other villages across the world where these same habits and characteristics are also found? Where people move around all day and work manually because they're farmers or shepherds or artisans, where they eat simple diets that are not highly processed with plants that they grew themselves in their yard or they bought at the local market, and where they also have close family and social ties and religion and all these bonds. Aren't these common characteristics of small, mainly rural communities a generation or two ago in the generation of our grandparents? And yet most of these places are not blue zones. They're not teeming with centenarians. Why not? Also, aren't there 1,000 other characteristics of the blue zones that didn't make it on that list of four keys? Is there something special about the climate of these regions? Dan Buettner does mention climate very briefly in the first episode, so I imagine this is something he has considered. But all blue zones are in areas with pretty good weather. I looked this up. 4 of the 5 blue zones fall almost exactly on the same latitude, 30 to 40 degrees north of the equator. Only the Costa Rican blue zone is closer to the equator. Why isn't there a blue zone in Siberia or in the Sahara? Maybe this is just a complete coincidence. Or maybe there is something to the right weather that is important. Not too hot, not too cold. All blue zones are in coastal regions. 3 of the 5 are islands. So is there something special about the water or the air? What about their genetics? Aren't genes really important for extreme longevity, for centenarianness? Scientists have identified genetic markers that explain, in some cases, up to 85% of extreme longevity. And we've looked at genes that help people live longer on a previous video. I'm not saying that genetics are the only factor that explains everything. I'm sure that if you take these centenarians and you move them to a Western city and you feed them junk, you're probably going to make them unhealthier. In fact, the show mentions that some of these regions are not blue zones anymore. They lost their status. The younger generations no longer live like their grandparents. And Okinawa, for example, there's a lot of junk food around and obesity has become very common and their longevity has decreased a lot. So I'm not saying genetics is the only factor, but isn't it a factor, a relevant factor? Aren't there lots of people who live very healthy lives and never make it to 100 or even close? There's a lot of romanticism around the blue zones and around ecological data in general, and this idea of going back to nature and going back to the way things were in bygone times. And there is some truth to that, I get that. But we have to take a second and not jump to conclusions. Sometimes correlations point to causation, sometimes they don't. And we find out by testing. Another question I have is whether looking at the number of centenarians is the best metric in the first place. I know we all have this fascination with the number 100. Reaching 100 years old, it's very gripping. But centenarians are rare, even in blue zones. In Sardinia, for example, they've estimated that for every 10,000 people born, 50 reach the age of 100. So that's half of 1%. Still really impressive compared to a lot of other areas of the world. But clearly, centenarians are a small percentage of the population. They're outliers, even in these hotspots. Isn't average life expectancy of a population a more relevant metric of health in general? Currently, the country with the highest life expectancy is Monaco. It used to be Hong Kong, but it was overtaken by a couple of countries. In Monaco, life expectancy is 84 years for men, 89 for women. This is almost identical to Okinawa in its peak in the 1980s, which was 84 for men and 90 for women. So Monaco's looking pretty darn good. Hey, maybe the secret to longevity is casinos and yachts. I'm half joking, but the point is, ecological data, although it's fascinating, can sometimes be a little arbitrary. We tend to handpick characteristics that already make sense to us. Centenarians in blue zones didn't have cell phones, didn't have laptops. Maybe that's the key to their longevity. I don't doubt for one second that moving around, eating a healthy diet, maintaining healthy body weight, these things are crucial for health. And if the show motivates people to live healthier lives, hey, absolute genius. But when we get super specific, it's this exact thing they do in the blue zones and this exact food and this exact activity that's the key to their longevity, That's really tricky. For example, in one episode, Den Buettner picks wine as one of the keys for longevity in Ikaria. But the scientific evidence, if anything, points against this idea. Could this be an example of seeing what we want to see? Another question that has also been raised is the reliability of the birth records in the blue zones. Are the ages accurate? So that's another question mark out there. Now, the last episode of the show really surprised me in a good way. After taking us through the five blue zones, Den Buettner sets out to create a new blue zone. He gets together with the officials of a small town in Minnesota, and they improve their environment. They get them to walk more, eat cleaner, and they estimate their health indices actually improve. And it seems they're doing this in a number of cities. It's called the Blue Zones Project. This is amazing, and it deserves enormous respect. I'm sure Den Buettner could have just rested on his laurels, written books and given speeches, comfortable life. The fact that he actually rolled up his sleeves and went to work to improve the health of a community, that's an incredible achievement. To me, the main value of the show is it puts the spotlight on the fundamentals of health. Diet, physical activity, healthy relationships, things that people often consider boring advice, but the show manages to make them look exciting. And that's an incredible contribution. Centenarians aren't walking around stressed out over the latest supplement pill or the hack from the podcast or the ice bath or some diet fad. They just have healthy habits sustained for a lifetime. Maybe their secret is that there is no secret. Bottom line, ecological data, like the blue zones, like the French paradox, and so many other examples, is fascinating to learn about, to gather ideas, but we should be careful not to let ourselves be taken by this wave of romanticism and overstate it. Also, and this is less about the show and more of a general point, if we're going to look at ecological data, we have to look at all of it. Normally what we see is the vegan gurus wax poetic about the blue zones, even though the blue zones are overwhelmingly not vegan, but that's another story. And then the keto gurus only want to talk about the Maasai and the Inuits, even though there's plenty of misunderstandings there as well. But it becomes kind of this Rorschach test where we see what we want to see. We look at the data and we conclude things that we already believed. So we got to look at all of it and we got to remember their limitations. They're really interesting ideas to be tested. Not more, not less. Here's a look at the French paradox, another example of ecological data. And here's a video about the science behind the Mediterranean diet. Could that be a key to longevity? Find out. I'll see you over there. Bye.